One second. Recording started. Admitting all. Welcome, everyone, to this another musical evening and conversation organized by Indian Finance Academy of San Diego. Today, we have Dr. Sriram Parashuram, a unique individual, which I'm sure Dr. Venkatachalam will talk more about in his intro. As we all utilize technology like Zoom that makes us possible to do programs like this, there are some unintended and potential technical issues with technology like this. So just to ensure everybody has the best experience of sitting back and listening to this musical conversation and watching it on Zoom, we kindly request everyone besides the main panelists to turn off their videos and mute your audio, at least for the first part of the program. When it comes to Q&A, please put your questions on the chat. One of us will pick it up and relay that to the to Dr. Sriram. And if needed, we will also unmute you at that time to ask your question. So please mute yourself and turn off your video. And I now hand you over to Srimati Revati Subramaniam for the introduction, and then Dr. C.M. Venkatachalam for moderating this session.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Narayanan. Greetings from San Diego. Namaste to all the viewers dialing in from all over the world. It is wonderful to be connecting with you all on a regular basis on this journey of musical enlightenment that we are all on by listening to some of the best musical minds of this generation on a variety of topics. San Diego is a very special place in North America, not only because of its wonderful weather, glorious views of the Pacific Ocean and the beaches, absolutely warm and friendly Californians that inhabit San Diego, but also because Bharat Ratna Pandit Ravi Shankar Ji chose to call this home, and it has become one of the most vibrant and sought after destinations in North America for Indian performing arts. I would say it is in large part due to Indian Fine Arts Academy San Diego, an organization that has done yeoman service to Indian performing arts for about 13 years now. My name is Revathi Subramanian, and I'm one of the managing trustees of Indian Fine Arts Academy San Diego. Since its inception in September 2007, we have staged about 230 concerts of Carnatic and Hindustani vocal and instrumental music, Bollywood music, world music, and various dance forms, including Kathak, Odissi, Kathakali, Bharatanatyam, Kuchipudi, Mohiniyattam, modern fusion dance, and so on, and also lecture demonstrations on various topics. We have staged an 8-day annual festival every year for the last 12 consecutive years. Over 1,000 artists from all over the world, including India, Canada, USA, UK, South Africa, Singapore, Malaysia, Dubai, etc., have performed here. Our annual festival is the second largest festival outside of India in the world and is attended by people from all over North America. In addition, we also stage an annual youth festival competitively selecting young talent from all over North America. Indian Fine Arts Academy is managed by a board of 19 music lovers, led very effectively by our president and secretary, Dr. Shekhar Vishwanathan, under the able guidance and advice from Dr. C.M. Venkatachalam. The organization thrives with the help of hundreds of volunteers whose help is greatly appreciated by all of us. We have decided that we are going to mark this COVID period with something very positive, with some wonderful online musical immersions this year, not only for San Diego audiences, but for rasikas from all over the world. We kicked off this conversation series organized by Indian Fine Arts Academy with a conversation with Sri Neyveli Santana Gopalan about a month and a half ago. About 4 weeks ago, we traveled all over India in the musical magic carpet with the one and only Srimati Aruna Sairam and her wonderful soulful music. We spoke to Sri Chitraveena Ravikiran a couple of weeks ago. Today, we have one of the most versatile musicians of this generation, who's equally well-versed in Hindustani and Carnatic music, Sri Sriram Parasuram. Conversing with him today is Sangeeta Seva Ratna, Dr. C.M. Venkatachalam, who's a well-known vocal music guru and Rasika in San Diego. It gives me great pleasure to introduce both of them. We are in for a wonderful treat this evening, or morning, you know, for people in India. Couple of quick housekeeping announcements. Please keep your audio and video muted. And if you have to leave the program and return, make sure that your video and audio are muted, you know, when you return. And if you have any questions, please keep typing them and we will try to get them answered, you know, throughout the program. I now hand it over to Dr. Venkatachalam.
Namaskaram. Thank you, Revati, for that wonderful introduction. I really enjoy how you do it. And that primarily comes from your conviction that we should do these lectums during this time. Dr. Sriram Parasuram is one of India's leading musicians today. He hails from a family steeped in music. His mother, Srimati Parvati Parasuram, is his primary guru. He has a master's degree in Western violin from University of Akron, Ohio, a PhD in Carnatic music and ethnomusicology from Wesleyan University under the guidance of Sangeeta Kalanidhi T. Vishwanathan. He has studied Hindustani music, being a senior disciple of Padma Bhushan Pandit C.R. Vyas of Kirana and Agra Gharana. He has accompanied on the violin some three generations of musicians. Let me read them, those musicians: M.D. Ramanathan, D.K. Pattamal, R.K. Srikantan, Nedanuri Krishnamurthy, M. Balamurli Krishna, Maharajapuram Santanam, through veterans like T.N. Seshagopalan, T.V. Sankaranarayanan, T.R. Subramaniam, N. Ramani, Mandolin U. Srinivas, Neveli Santana Gopalan, Sanjay Subramaniam, T.M. Krishna, Chitraveena Ravikiran. Gives you an idea of the breadth of the people for whom he has accompanied in violin. He was awarded President of India Gold Medal for both Carnatic as well as Hindustani violin. He's a top grade artist in All India Radio and Doordarshan for both Carnatic and Hindustani violin. There are several awards he has given. He has been given Ustad Amir Khan Award, M.S. Subbalakshmi Award, Vishwakala Puraskar Award, Kalaima Mani from Tamil Nadu. Also, he is very well known for lectums, an extremely scholarly presentation covering a wide ranging topic in music, not just Carnatic, not just Hindustani, not just Indian music, the entire world music. We are in for a treat. It's with great pleasure I invite Dr. Sriram. The question I have is that you have selected a topic that says the continuum between Shastriya Sangeeta or Carnatic or Hindustani classical music and folk music is as a continuum. So my main question to start this discussion is, how does music originate? Where does it originate? Please, Dr. Sriram.
Very good morning to all my friends and well-wishers and gurus in India, and a very good evening to all of you watching from the US, all my friends and well-wishers there. I shall begin. I like to begin with singing, you know, that's, so I shall begin with something, and then I will go on to answer Venkat sir's question, and we shall proceed from there.
Ganesh Kumara Pagi Mam, Ganesh Kumara Pagi Mam, Gajamukha Ganesh Kumara Pai Mam Gajamukha Ganesha Kumara Pai Mam Gajamukha Ganesha Kumara Pai Mam Manorata Siddhi Dayaka Manorata Siddhi Dayaka Manorata Siddhi Dayaka Gama Padadi Nuta Bhavashi Uduvahita Gajamukha Ganesha Kumara Paimam Manorata Siddhi Dayaka Gama Padadi Nuta Bhavashi Uduvahita Gajamukha Ganesha Umara Pahima. Valli Kanavan Perai, Valli Pokar Sonnalum, Valli Kanavan Perai, Valli Pokar Sonnalum, Ullam Kuraye Dadi, Kiliye Unumurug Dadi. வள்ளி கணவன் பெறை வழி போக்க சொன்னாலும் உள்ளம் குழையதடி கிளியே ஊனுமுருகுதடி கிளியே ஊனுமுருகுதடி மடுமனை போனால் என்ன மடுமனை போனால் என்ன மக்கள் சுற்றம் போனால் என்ன மாடு மனை போனால் என்ன மக்கள் சுற்றம் போனால் என்ன கொடி சென்பொன் போனால் என்ன கிளியே புகுநகை போதுமடி குமரன் புகுநகை போதுமடி Savaro Manubhar Savaro Manubhar Atahi Sukhapava Thakhi Mad Dhularo Rejavaro ஹட சாவரோ மனுவார் அத்தகி சுகபாவ தகி மத துலாரோ ஜவாரோ ஆடோ ஜமுனா கே தட்ட சாவரோ மன கல்லார்க்கும் கற்றவர்க்கும் களிப்பருளும் களிப்பே கல்லார்க்கும் கற்றவர்க்கும் களிப்பருளும் களிப்பே ஆனார்க்கும் கண்டவர்க்கும் கண்ணளிக்கும் கண்ணே வல்லார்க்கும் மாட்டார்க்கும் வல்லார்க்கும் மாட்டார்க்கும் வரமளிக்கும் வரமே மதியார்க்கும் மதிப்பவர்க்கும் மதி கொடுக்கும் மதியே மதியார்க்கும் மதியார்க்கும் மதிப்பவர்க்கும் மதி கொடுக்கும் மதியே என் சிவமே என் சிவமே என் சிவமே
எல்லாருக்கும் நமஸ்காரம். I sang four bits of excerpts from four compositions, all in different, all coming from different genres. But you can experience the continuity, the similarity in all of them. It is called Jyoti in the Hindustani tradition. It is called Jhanjyoti by Dikshitar, Muthuswami Dikshitar, in the first composition that I sang. It is called Chenjuriti also in common parlance of Carnatic music. All of them are referring to the same musical entity. So this is where we begin. In terms of I chose this particular so-called raga or mit. A raga is a codified, systematized, defined and shastra based setting for music. That is what we call in Carnatic or Hindustani. It is a shastra based setting. The melodic seed, the melodic element of shastra in Carnatic music is raga, or Hindustani music is raga. The same role is played by what we call in Tamil mit. Mit again refers to the idea of a musical setting. Varnamitte or mit. Varna means descriptive. A descriptive musical setting is called a mit. So, Venkatachalam, our keta, he asked the question, where does this music come from? Where does it begin? The answer for it is very philosophical. It begins with the aspiration of the human soul to experience beauty in sound. The idea of nada, the idea of beautiful sound, is part of our makeup. Our essential intrinsic makeup is to experience beauty outside, whether it be visual or whether it be oral. So this search for beauty, beauty in nature, our own nature, the nature outside, both of them being essentially the same, is where music begins. Then as the human soul seeks more and more different varieties, different kinds of beauty, because the world of nada is infinite. How many ever ragas, how many ever mits, how many ever tunes, it still seems absolutely unfathomable, inexhaustible. Correct. So it is that seeking in man. Mankind wants, humankind wants to seek beauty in sound. That's where the idea of music is born. This idea of music has developed through the ages, through centuries and centuries of mankind, humankind, nourishing it with his thinking, his philosophy, his striving, his endeavoring of making the sound more and more beautiful, more and more meaningful, integrating everything into it, because humankind is a greedy species. It wants more and more. And that is the glory of the species also. In a sense, it seeks. The seeker is not happy with status quo. The seeker wants to go ahead and ahead, get more things, embrace more things. So the idea of something beginning in what we generally term as folk. What does folk mean? Folk means where things are integrated into one's daily life. Generally speaking, we can think of folk music as those elements of a singing or an instrument playing practice, say for a festival occasion, or say for harvesting season, or say when the boatman goes to sea, or even, you know, every season that brings different kinds of joys. So for every season a song, for every event in a humankind's progress in life, Even when a girl attains maturity, puberty, there are hundreds of songs. So in India especially, we are a country of singing and songs. Give us the smallest excuse and we burst into song. Correct? You know, we don't have, actually we don't have anything called poetry as such. We have drama within which is poetry, but our poetry is always sung. Whether it be Tevaram or Tirupugal or Tumri or anything, we always sing. Veerabai sang, Andal sang, Appar, Sundarar, Arunagirinadar, Kabir, all of us sang. All of us continue to sing. We love to sing as a species and as a culture in India. You know, you look at the channels, you know, in Indian channels, especially Malayalam channels, you switch it on and somebody's always singing. Whether they are singing nice or very proficiently, nobody cares. We just love to sing. So that is the basis of music. In the sense, a stirring of the heart to seek beauty in sound. So in this particular travel of this Chenjoti, Janjoti, Jinjoti, we see that very beautiful connection. Essentially, we are all folk. None of us are non-folk. We have been urbanized. We have got ourselves into frameworks of organization, discipline within music. And hence, we consider ourselves artists or rasikas of classical music. But when the person on the trains in Bombay starts singing, you know, the call of the voice, or when you hear, when you go to the villages and somebody is singing randomly sitting on the veranda, or when you find ladies coming together in a marriage function and singing, that joy is something very, very, very spontaneous. There is no training there. The training is there as an intuitive basis. You know, what we call kelvijnanam, listening to the elders singing and then you growing up in that atmosphere, then you start singing. It's just as natural as breathing for them. You know? So if you consider yourself a rasika, you have to realize that the greatest rasika is the folk person. Because there is nothing intermediary in terms of the intellect or anything. That kind of conditions is listening to music. So I like to think of myself as a folk musician also. Why not? Why do we need to place it in a lesser status? You know? So I like the great Kumar Gandharva said once that the pukar, the call of the folk singer, he can never achieve. Ye jo drawing room mein baithe hum gaate hain, वो जो पुकार आवाज है, I'm just saying it kind of verbatim in Hindi, that call of the voice I cannot get, he says. So it is that very, very primordial, very pure, spontaneous call of the voice that folk represents for me. Folk represents the origin of everything, whether it be raga, whether it be tala, whether it be instruments. You know, whether it be expression, aesthetics, folk represents the root of it all. We shall see how, in very tangible terms, as we proceed through this lecture, as to how we can substantiate and realize that and give it that importance. Classical musicians and classical music rasikas generally have a holier than thou. I say this with a lot of caution. But we do have a holier-than-thou attitude towards other musics, say folk or tribal or Natupura Padal or film music. We tend to think a little lower of it, correct? That's because there is a certain training and a process by which we have assimilated for Carnatic music or Hindustani music. And hence it is that sense of doing or pride that probably conditions us to think of classical music as the greatest thing happened to humankind. It's not true. It is just an attitude. Yes, Venkatachalam, sir.
So, very beautifully expressed, and you're singing of Chanchurati, and I think the other Hindustani version, Chanchurati, you can explain. So, how do ragas evolve? Do they travel? I mean, have we obtained Chanchurati from Chanchurati or the other way?
Absolutely. There is no raga that emanates. Most of the ragas have their beginnings in the folk itself. For example, the idea of Jhanj Uti. It's a description. Jhanj is that the big talam instrument, what we call the kinnara. Kinnaram we say. That is also called Jhanj in the Hindustani. So in the north, so Jhanj Uti means the sound of the cymbal has begun. So that Jhanj Uti becomes Jhinjoti, that Jhinjoti becomes Chanchurati. Actually, Dikshitar names the raga as Jhanjuti. In his Sangeeta Sampradaya Pradarshini, the Ganesha Kriti that I sang, it is named Jhanjuti. So the word process itself, we can see as to how, this is not a classical nomenclature. How can Jhanjuti be a classical nomenclature? Correct. So in classical music, we have later on, as the system has become more and more sophisticated, we decided to, all these ragas are what is referred to in Hindi as dhun ugam. Dhun ugam means coming out of a tune. I use the word tune as a parallel to the word metric that I used. Essentially, all ragas are a tune. We find out the framework of that tune, and then prescribe aroha avroha, derive the most essential, most beautiful features from that tune, and we call it a murchana. I'm just using these technical terms as we use it in classical. So raga means it has to have aroha avroha, it has to have a murchana, it has to have murchanas, and it has to have a swarupa, a bhava or a swarupa. So if you sing sahana, raga sahana, the raga shahana, Kannada, from where Sahana, our Sahana has come, Carnatic Sahana has come, also traces a travel of the raga. Right? It travels from the north. Shahana means, Shah means Allah in the courts of Akbar or even earlier. Shahana refers to the representative of the king as the representative of the Lord, of their Godhead. Right? So Shahana originates in the courts. And then it travels. And then it travels through to the south. And then we have this very, very beautiful raga in which all the composers, Tyagaraja, Dikshitar, Kama Shastri, all of them have composed. And today Shahana is a well-entrenched raga in Carnatic music, correct? So many such travels. From the south, a raga like Bilawal travels to the north. We think Bilawal is a raga named as a Urdu name, but it is not. The Velauli tribes of Nilgiris is where this melody originates. You know, what we call Shankarabharanam, right? Which is the equivalent of Bilawal. A part of the melody has been there in folk. It has traveled through trading routes, through conquests, through capturing of soldiers, through so many processes. It has traveled through to the north. The Velauli tribe, the Velauli tune becomes Bilawal, it becomes Bilawal. Correct? So you see that a lot of the ragas, a raga like Saurashtram, right? All of you know Saurashtram and Carnatic music, right? Saurashtram, the name itself suggests it is coming from Saurashtra. A raga like Surati comes from the Surat Des, a raga called Surat Des. A raga like Gaud Malhar or Gaud Saranga comes from the Gauda Desa. Even a Maya Malava Gauda. Yeah? Dikshitar says this. Maya Malava Gauda Di Desa. So, the Gauda Desa Lendu Vanda Oru, it is a tune which is emanated from the Gauda Desa, which refers to today's Bengal. Malava refers to the Malvi region of Madhya Pradesh. So these radhas are not constrained by your demographic or your language, linguistic or your political state borders. They travel free, like the COVID virus. Just to give you, it doesn't know any regionality or nationality. It just travels. That is its nature. So radha also just travels, whether it be from the folk tune to the classical, or from a northern region to the southern region, or vice versa. So you have to understand the basic nature of what a melody is. A beautiful melody cannot be constrained. It will travel. From classical, it will move to film if a music director likes it. Dixit had traveled all over India. Wherever he traveled, wherever he found beautiful melodies, he co-opted it into the Carnatic music stream. So there is a great amount of eclectic, that broad-minded giving and taking within the realm of music. And that's where folk plays a very important role. Folk doesn't care about its grammar or shastra. It just is. Whereas the mette or the tunes, the dhun. Dhun again means refers to the word tune. That dhun is taken in by the Shastriya Sangeetakara, Shastriya Sangeetajna. Refers to either the composer or the singer. Right from, I'm not talking about now or last 200, 500 years. I'm talking about since ages where these are co-opted. Sangeet Ratnakara, all of them make a note of the folk melodies. In fact, in the classification of Carnatic ragas of Indian music theory, the three-part subjective classification of Ghanaraga, Raktiraga and Desya Raga. Ghana Naya Desya or Ghana Rakti Desya. Desya refers to all the melodies which are born out of the Desa, that is the land. This refers to folk. So a Senjuriti or an Adhanama Kriya, these ragas or a Punnagavarali in Carnatic are all essentially from folk sources. Even in terms of when we talk of ragas, in the north too, the influences of regional folk songs and how the greatest of ustads and greatest of gayaks, composers, whether it be Sadarang, Gadarang, they are freely taken in from that. That's why you will have, a family of ragas. For example, the raga Mand, correct? You know the raga Mand? You may not regard it as very kind of classical, cherished, high class, right? But it is still such a beautiful melody. Carnatic rasikas like Desiya ragas most. Let me make that statement here. Your Kurai Ondru Millai or your all the popular tukdas, 90% of Lal Gudisar's Tilanas are in Desiya ragas. Let us accept that fact. It is in Desh and Mand and Pahadi and Bihag. All these are Desiya ragas. Amir Kalyani, all Desiya ragas. Correct. So we have to be honest about accepting and recognizing the role of the Desa, the land, which is the folk, as the most important impetus and spirit of classical music. It need not be an either or. It can be a wonderful assimilation of the two. Correct? Am I making sense to all of you? Yeah. Yeah, please go ahead, Venkatachalam. You can guide me through as to, otherwise I'll go rambling on.
Yes, just beautiful how you connect these ideas. Immediately a question occurs, how does the raga change when it comes, let's say, travels from north to south? You talked about Shahana.
Yeah.
How is it sung in Hindustani versus Carnatic? Yeah. If you give a few examples, we will know how they were related at least, or do they completely change? And
they do. The rubric of the raga, that is the framework of the raga, is taken in by an aesthetic of the Carnatic or the Hindustani. The Hindustani aesthetic is definitely different. It is unique. The Carnatic aesthetic is definitely different. in terms of the gamakas, in terms of the compositional forms, and so much more. So, for example, since you asked about Shahana, in the north it is Jayaranarana. It's a kind of a Kannada. Manidani sada pa padama risa 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 dama pada manida dani sa risa sada mari sada bundela uri malani bundela uri malani phoolon ka tera aaj bana banari ko mubarak gunde lauri malani gunde lauri malani. This is Shahana Kannada. Now, how does it become Shahana? So, gamari, gamapa madada. If you see, dani papa madamari, gundela ori malani. The Gandhara changes. But actually, Shahana, you know how it was sung? It was actually sung with a shruti for the Gandhara, which is in between the two Gandharas. Pama gamari, gamapa madada. This gamari is a Kannada anga. Gamari sada ni sa di di sa. No, what am I singing? I'm singing Kannada. Right. Pama gamari gamapa madada.
Vandanamu Raghunandana. Setu bandhana bhakta chandana rama gamarisa.
That's how the stalwarts used to sing. Now, of course, we have sanitized it and made it an antara gandhara.
Pama gamarisa.
That's how it used to be sung. Vishwasar, my teacher, my guru, used to sing that.
Sri Kamalambi Vayam.
So the Sanis are the same phrase in the Hindustani. If you take a Begada, for example, right? We think Begada is a very Karnataka raga, but it has traveled. It doesn't matter whom it belongs to. The whole of India, the whole of the world is ours. Right? So in Hindustani, it is called Bihagada. In fact, in Karnataka, the older generation used to call it as Piyakada, not as Begada. Piyakada tha ennodu guru solvar, Vaidyanath Bhagavatar. Piyakada solva. They don't say it as Begada. Right? So that
Sagama Pama Pagasa. Gama pada ma pa
that is the chalan of Bihagada.
E madira va me ab mandira va me aaye nahi pritam pya e sakhi mori madir ba me.
What is our Begada?
Dava varisa sanida pasagariga.
Correct?
There it is madir ba me.
The gamakas are different. But our
Tyagarajaya namaste, namaste.
You see that it's a mirroring of the same idea, the musical idea. So ragas do travel, hundreds of ragas. Ragas from the south travel to the north. And abhogi becomes
Sarigamadasadamagari.
This is our Abhavi, right?
Sabhapati kiver devam samanamaguma. Tillai sabhapati kiver devam samanamaguma. Tillai.
This transforms itself as sariga ri
riga sari gamari.
It takes the anga of Kannada.
Gamari sa sari da sari gamada sa da maga mada sa da magari riga magamari sa laje. More laje, oh, more laje. Tuma to data.
It's the same Abhuti notes. The framework is the same. But like I said, the Murchanas, what is called the pakad or the chalan of the raga in Hindustani, those might change. But the inspiration comes from the same entity, which is either Abhuti or whatever. And there are hundreds of such. Examples of the music traveling. Like I said, either Muthuswami Dikshita traveled to the north and assimilated those ragas, or Swadhi Trinal, the king, the beautiful, absolutely artistic king that he was, he used to invite musicians from the north to his court and regale in listening to them and then compose in those ragas himself. So Dhanashri Tilana, which we know,
Gita Dhuni Gita Kadim Nadridirtirtom Nach Ragi Gori Tadi Tai 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 Tiragata Gita Dhuni.
Right, very popular. Dhanashri is a Hindustani raga.
Or Saramaina Matalanta Chalu Salura Sami Saramaina Matalanta chalu chalu ra cha ta vi saramaina matalanta chalu chalu ra.
Bihag is a very solid, a very important raga in the Hindustan. Hamsadhwani, which Ustad Abdul Karim Khasa adopted. Kirvani, which they adopted from us. So the travel is amazing. Kirvani is known as in the Hindustani folk tradition, it is either called Multani Kafi or it's called Sindhi Bhairavi. Sindhi Bhairavi itself tells you it is part of the Sindh region of northwestern India. So this Kirvani has already existed. It's fascinating. Kirvani exists as a folk melody in the Thumri light classical tradition in the north. But Kirvani in the south is a very classical raga. Kirvani, the naming itself means the sound of the goddess, the Vedas. Kirvani, Akashavani, Kirvani. But then this Kirvani from the south gets folded back into the classical tradition of the north. And now in the north, there are two entities, both of which are very similar. One is Sindhi Bhairavi or Multani Kafi, which is in the folk, and one is Kirvani as a classical raga. But actually, if you go to see, both of them are the same. So this idea of nomenclature and traveling of ragas is so fascinating to observe. You know? Yeah.
So, you are...
1 minute, I have... My tambura got disconnected. I will just... Give me 1 minute. I will see what the problem is and then come back. So this raga, since I mentioned Kirvani, I will sing a little bit of Sindhi. I like to sing, whether you like it or no, I like to sing more than I like to speak.
We like it. We like it a lot.
So this raga called Multani Kafi or Kafi or Sindhi Bhairavi.
Satiro Roma Bata Nihara.
This is Kirvani.
Tani Dava Magari Sani Sarigama Padanisa.
This is called Bhultani Gafu.
Satiro Roma Bata Nihara. Saval Mor Muhara. Saval Mor Muhara. Tati ro roma, bat nihara. Saval Mor Muhara. Saval Mor Muhara. Saval Mor Muhara.
Very beautiful melody, right? Like the composition, the film song. You know?
Ayena Balam Kakaru Sajani.
These are all songs which are coming from the same root, you know. The idea of the Anyaswara, what we call as the foreign note. Some of you may know that the idea of a pure raga and an impure raga. This is also a problem. I don't accept this. Ashuddha raga, ashuddha raga. Those concepts are not relevant to me anymore. So even the idea of anya, I don't accept. Because anya means the other. Or it is not actually. We have chosen to name it as the anya. It was integral to the raga. If you take a raga like Ananda Bhairavi, like for example, why I brought it up, is that in the north, this mishra, the idea of, for example,
Tatiro Rama Bhata Nihara.
The Kaisiki Nishada, the lower value of the Nishada, is not part of the description of Kirvani. But it comes as a beautiful adornment in the folk. Right? So the folk is not concerned about Kaisiki or Kakali or Sadharana or whatever. Okay? Whatever is beautiful, whatever comes to that man who is singing this melody or the woman who is singing this melody is beautiful. That's it. That's the beginning and end of it. There's no need for a grammar or for it to fall within a scientific paradigm, Shastra paradigm. For example, a raga like Ananda Bhairavi, right? We will say the learned people who have gone to college and done their B music, MA music, they will say Ananda Bhairavi is a raga with three Anyaswaras. Now this need for telling that it is three foreign notes is because you want to put Ananda Bhairavi, which is essentially a folk melody, into the rubric of this Mela scheme. So Karharapriya Janya, you will call, even though Ananda Bhairavi has existed much before Karharapriya. So the idea of even Janya Janaka is flawed. I'm being very open about these things. I don't mean any disrespect to the theoreticians, but it is flawed because the raga of Ananda Bhairavi has existed before its father, which is Karharapriya. So it is anachronistic and doesn't make any sense. So I don't use that terminology, that classical terminology anymore. Because some of these ragas, you have to give it its due. It has come from the folk. And it has existed much before you decide to make a Sampurna Mela structure. Yes, the structure is beautiful. It helps us in so many different ways. But we also have to be alive of its the problems that it gives in terms of representing the truths. So Ananda Bhairavi.
Tada na 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 tada ra na tada ra na na ra tada na tada na na tada ra na tada na Paluke Bangara Mayena Kodanda Pani Paluke Bangara Mayena.
Right, this beautiful melody is essentially a folk metre. So Ramadasa Kirtana, Paluke Bangara Mayena, is a Bhadrachala Ramadasa Kirtana. But it has been set in this, which is essentially a folk melody.
Paluke bangaramaya pilichina paluka vemi kalaloni nada smarana maravacha kani tandri paluke bangaramayanna.
So that antara gandhara.
Pamagama pamama.
Even an Ananda Vairavi Alapana in a classical music stage is incomplete without this. Venkatachalam sir will know, all the people who have heard Ananda Vairavi will know that this is an integral part of Ananda Vairavi. You cannot say it is an Anyaswara. It is not the other, it is part of Ananda Vairavi. Similarly, the Shuddha Daivata.
Pama ga ma pama ga ma bada bada ga ga. Dama bagari.
Right, that prayoga also. The Shuddha Daivata. So in Kamalamba Navavarna of Muthuswami Dikshitar, the third so-called Anyaswara, the Takali Nishada, comes in replete, in absolutely unabashedly it comes. We are sometimes shy to use so much of the Takali Nishada. But Muthuswami Dikshitar seems to revel in that.
Kamalamba samrakshatu mam hrit kamala nagara nivasi.
In the Anupalavi,
sumanasara ditabjamukhi sundara mana priya kadasaki pasadanisa.
That's how my Vishwasar used to sing. We have sanitized it.
Sumanasara ditabjamukhi.
That's how we will sing Ananda Vairavi.
Priya nisa nisa panida pamagama.
We have sanitized this as
Sumanasara Ditabjamukhi Gama.
Right?
Sundara Mana Priya Karasaki Nida.
We have made it adhere to the Janakaraga of Karara. But it was not like that. So why I'm explaining that it's a continuum. I'm not finding fault with anybody's way of singing this. But essentially, one has to understand that Ananda Bhairavi is a folk melody. We, Shama Shastri, for example, revels in Ananda Bhairavi, right? You all know that. You know, maximum number of compositions of Shama Shastri, the great composer, is in Ananda Bhairavi and Riti Gowda. So you have this very wonderful Pokisham, the treasure of the folk, that we have adapted, and we are very joyful singing and listening to that. So that is the continuum. In Andhra Pradesh, Nedunuri Krishnamurti Garu says, every household used to sing Ananda Bhairavi. The woman of the house, whether it be in the village or the town, used to sing Ananda Bhairavi as talate, as a lullaby, you know, for festival occasions, for auspicious occasions, for prayer. Many prayers were sung in Ananda Bhairavi. So we realize that it's a melody of the land. And it has come into classical music and become richer and become more expansive. And we today have hundreds of compositions. And we can do, I have also done Ragam Ganam Pallavi. I performed in Ananda Bhairavi. Such a major raga it has become. It has become a very larger than life entity, and it gives us so much joy. It is not a folk versus classicism, classical. It's the continuum that I revel in, you know. And so many such ragas. A Mukhari, a Husseini, all of these. If you study the history of some of these ragas, they have come out of nowhere. This nowhere means it has come out of folk. Because the folk is not recognized in musicology as such in terms of historical or, the process of folk. Now people study it. While at Wesleyan, I had the opportunity to study paradigms of folk. As to what is folk, how it means to people. In India, the musicology till very lately has been mainly in the classical realms. And hence, probably now there's a revival, there's a rethinking of wanting to study folk, the processes, the people, the settings, everything that, you know, what is called today is cultural geography, where you study the place and you study all the cultural things which emanate from that. Yeah. Venkatachalam sir, or Revathi ma'am.
Revathi, could you bring up questions from the audience at this point?
Yes.
I also wanted to speak about compositional forms.
Yes.
How the folk classical continuum. Yeah. You know, a form like the Javali, you know, which we now sing. Javali is very raw and honest Shringara, the words, lyrics. It was felt by some people that maybe it was not appropriate for the stage. See, the stage is the classical stage. The concert stage is a totally decontextualized musical setting. Songs which were sung in the temples, we sing on the stage. That's why many people say Tevaram, Tirupugal and all. It's not maybe proper, correct to sing on the stage. Because it is a decontextualizing. The Oduvar say the Tevaram is supposed to be sung in front of the Lord in the temple. That is where it was. And when we present it, of course, there are differing views on this. We have to be very accommodative. I am just presenting all views to you. So you decide. But one thing is a fact that, for example, if T.R. Mahalingam brought in, you know, Nandavana Tilorandi, that is a Siddhar part. People used to look forward to this the maximum, you know. People will not, Enamari Bhairavi Vasarna, there are going to be few. But when there is Nandavanathil or Andi, and he will mingle it with Magudi, which is also a folk kind of a form, Janang, the people are so, so happy. That's the only thing they will remember when they go back. Which goes to show that our connect with the folk is still very alive. Whether you are in America, or whether you are in Barbados, or whether you are in Kumbakonam, your connection with the folk is still very, very alive. Sometimes we fail to look at that. Right? Nandavana Tilorandi. I forget. Da 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 Ada kutadi kutadi potu daitandi, a very deep meaning. That is, this fellow goes to ask for a pot. After 10 months, the pot is given to him. But this fellow, kutadi kutadi potu daitandi, he broke it by misusing the pot. So the pot is for the human being. You know, the human Nandavanam is the earth. And the giver is the actual maker of this pot is Ishvara. So, on the depth, Gudi Siddhar Padal. And this, T.R. Mahalingam introduces, and then everybody after him, on the violin, on the mandolin, on everybody plays the song, and nobody says this is a folk element. Or a Javali, nobody says it is folk. So, many, many elements from in the north, the Tumri, the Rasiya, the Kajri, the Dadra, the Chaiti, all essential folk.
Yeah.
But the greatest of musicians like Bade Gola Malik Khan Sahib, Siddheshwari Devi, they have, co-opted this to an extent that today Girija Devi, Srimati Girija Devi, who just passed away, was a Thumri specialist. She didn't sing much of classical. But she's regarded as one of the greatest classical musicians ever because of her mastery of the Thumri. Yeah. So when a Maad Meikum Kanna comes in a Kacheri, it's essentially folk. Even Uthukade, though we have a lot of the compositions are having a lot of folk elements in it. Like I said, Tirupugal, Tevaram, Devarnamas of Purudaradasa. The devotional has always been folk. Like I said, the folk includes us in many ways.
Yeah.
So when I sing even though it is set in a Jaunpuri or a, now for example, this
Rama Mantra Bajapi So He Manuja, Rama Mantra Bajapi So He Manuja, Rama Mantra Bajapi So He Manuja, Rama Mantra Bajapi So Amantra E Mantra.
Very good. So this composition, look at it. It's in Raga Jaunpuri, which is a North Indian Raga. Okay. It is in a Raga. It is from a Dasar Pada. It's a Dasar Pada of Purandara Dasa, which is essentially folk. They all sang in Unjavritti and in temples. They didn't sing on stages as classical music. We have co-opted them. They have existed as folk only. What is essentially folk is what they are. And then it has been given the form of a Kriti, which is a classical musical genre. And then we have put lot of Sangadis. Sangadis means variations.
Rama Mantra Bajapi So He.
That is the basic line.
Rama Mantra Bajapi So He Manuja.
The Sangadi. It's T.N. Seshagopalan sir. Right? This is the tuning by him. So look at the liberty with which we have co-opted so many different things into our mind sense of what Carnatic music is. So there are a lot of things which I want, like Javalis. For example, in Nata Kurunji.
Tarumaruladeve me bajari, tarumaruladeve me bajari, tarumaruladeve me.
The Sangadi in Nata Kurunji is not there in the original Javali. The words of the lyrics also not respectable, so to speak. Here the Nayaka Bhava calls the lady as Bajari. Bajari means, you know. So, but then I am singing it. Vishwasar, my guru sang it. Vrindama sang it on the stage. So it's a borrowed genre. The word Javali comes from the word Javadi, which is a Karnataka folk genre. So if you do some research, many of these things are having that continuum of where we have in the classical music we have. And the folk is a very free idiom. Today in the folk, they even, I was documenting Yakshagana in Carnatic. And today I found so many film songs have integrated into it. On one hand, I can bemoan the fact that this pure Yakshagana I was seeking to document. But there is no pure Yakshagana because the folk doesn't believe in these concepts of purity and maintaining integrity. Whatever is beautiful, it integrates.
Yeah, Sri Ram
ji, it is this continuum which we have to, which we are talking about today. Yes,
yeah.
Sorry.
Sri Ram ji, so I just want to combine a few different questions from the audience and maybe just a few minutes, two or three minutes to answer this. By the way, such a pleasure to hear you go from folk to Hindustani to Carnatic. I mean, you're just a magician, right? Just beautiful, beautiful. So one of the questions here is, in terms of this commonality of genres, this is from Sri Vaidyanathan Ramaswamy. Is this commonality of genres with regard to tunes prevalent more in certain types of ragas only? For example, what about Ganaragas? That's one question. But I want to ask you a couple of more questions as well. You know, we have only about 25 minutes or so left. Second question is it okay for someone to learn Carnatic and Hindustani simultaneously? That was another question. And earlier, you talked about Ananda Bhairavi and how it is used pretty much in every house for Talati and stuff like that. Perhaps you could just show that a little by singing. So I'm just combining a few different questions.
Okay.
Please.
The first question is, yes, the Ganaragas are a process of two things. One is the intense amount of intellectual and artistic energy that has been put into it. Raga is not born as Gana. Okay, Bhairavi is Bhairavi, Shankarabharanam is Shankarabharanam. It becomes Gana because of a certain selection process of that particular raga and it being embellished and nourished so much. You understand? So Bhairavi becomes Bhairavi, this larger than life entity, or a Shankarabharanam is so big, or a Todi is so big. A Todi is so big because of one person called T. N. Rajaratnam Pillai. Right? Because his nourishment, his contribution to the raga has been so immense. As Manodharma, Todi is considered as one of the greatest of ragas. As infinite Manodharma possible. So we have to remember that these ragas do. Yes, there is a sankalpa of Ishvara, of Saraswati is there, that these ragas have to become so big. Everything that we do is her sankalpa. Right? But it is not as if intrinsically the raga is more beautiful or more significant. For example, the raga Kamboji was a melody which has come from Cambodia. Right? Kamboj Desa. Kamboj Desa, there are two Kamboj Desas, okay? We still don't know. It is still, the ruling is out. The verdict is still in pending. There is a Kamboj which is referred to as the present day Cambodia. There is a Kamboj Raja near Afghanistan also. Now, where this melody came from, we don't know. Okay? So this raga is not as if it is a big raga to begin with. It has been made big by the poshaka, the nourishment, the nurturing of this raga through the hands of, say, Purandaradasa, earlier composers, and Tyagaraja, and Dikshitar, and Shama Sastri, and later composers also. Right? The Todi raga, the naming itself, is a very non-classical naming. What is Todi? It doesn't mean anything. The Todas, a tribal form, the tribal group in the Nilgiris, Todas, is probably where this has come, this melody has come. Of course, it has been nourished and totally changed in terms of its exploration. A raga like Bhairavi, it used to exist as a pun called Kausika. There are Tevarams in this which Odhuvar still sing. And we are talking about compositions which are thousands of years old. Kardalagi Kasindhi Kandir Malgi Odhuvar Tamai Nannari Kuipade Vedam Nangilum மெய் பொருளாவது நாதநாமம் நமஜீவாயவே. This is a Odhuvar Panna. But look at how Vishwasar, I learned this from him, he has taken that Kausikam and made it into the most beautiful, elegant Bhairavi. Right? So it is not as if Bhairavi has existed as a direct prasada from Bhagavan. It has existed in folk and fun, etc., for a long time. Right? So all these dhanaragas also have their own life story to tell you. I look at ragas as organic, beautiful human beings or living things. They have a history, they have a process, they will have ups and downs. Some ragas will get neglected. They will get co-opted again, maybe 50 years, 60 years, 100 years later. So they have their own life story. You know, that's what endears me to the raga so much. That's why I revel in the raga as that's why we call them the devata, because there is so much of joy and love there. The second question that you asked is about whether one can learn Hindustani and Carnatic at the same time. You know, it's not an easy task. One system kattukkaradhukku romba janmam vendi irukku. We need hundreds of janmas to master one tradition. It is important. I was blessed with great opportunities having been in Bombay from a very, very, very young age. I remember listening to Bade Gulam Ali Khan when I was 3 years old. So my father, my parents believed in the absolute non-differential way of what music is. Especially Indian classical music. So being in Bombay, later on, I picked up all, though I started learning classic Carnatic very formal way, the sounds of the Hindustani were also feeding me and nourishing me. Mm. So for an All India Radio competition, without having learned Hindustani music, I entered and I got the first prize. And then I had to Then the radio program started coming. Every 3 months, one contract will come. I was automatically placed in B high grade, which is also rare, which means I would have done something correctly in the Hindustani thing. Okay. So then it forced me to go and find a guru. And that's how I went to first Pandit K.G. Ginde, great man. So he directed me to Pandit C.R. Vyas, with whom I learned for 10-12 years. So these opportunities presented themselves to me. It's my bhagyam. It's my blessing. The thing is that to learn both simultaneously can be confusing.
Correct.
Because the use of the voice, the aesthetics, the way one develops the manodharma are all different. The language is different. So for me, what really worked in my advantage is that by the time I started learning my Hindustani, by God's grace and by the generosity of my Carnatic gurus, my Carnatic was on a very solid foundation. You still cannot shake me in my Carnatic music. My Carnatic music will not, my Kirvani will sound like Kirvani in Carnatic. It will sound, it's not my doing. It's my opportunities and my gurus. But if you are starting at a later age, and if your footing or grounding in one is not strong, then you will be very confused. It will confuse your voice. It will confuse your mind. So I will always suggest that you become pakka in one tradition. I have a student who is 64 now, you know. So he comes from the Rangaramanujayangar family. So he's also a good example of how his Carnatic footing was through hearing. And his learning thing was in Hindustan. Very fascinating, the kind of opportunities and settings through which we go. So there is no one prescription. To understand and to be able to execute classical music is exceptionally difficult.
Right.
I will tell you that the intelligence, we don't recognize it. The musical intellect required to be a good singer or an instrumentalist is on par with being a rocket scientist or one of those computer wizards.
Absolutely.
It requires so much of the mind. So it all depends on so many elements, whether... So I will not prescribe, but yes, as a Rasika, you don't have any boundaries. You can listen to both and revel and take the joy out of both of them. And if you feel inspired, do learn. But be aware that there is an issue of keeping them separate is what I cherish. The aesthetics have to be different. And you have to work for it. You have to work harder.
Right.
You have to work double the time. Yeah.
You are a true Indian treasure, right? I mean, mastering both styles.
Like I said, it's the blessings of my parents and my gurus. Because these opportunities don't come for everybody, right? Being in a city like Bombay, which is a cosmopolitan city, so much of Hindustani music around. And plus being a South Indian from a family of South Indians who speak Tamil. And, you know, so the opportunities were different. So like that. Yeah.
So, the time is short and I can hear you all night. Let me tell you, you are considered an exceptional instrumentalist. In fact, I must say something about Vishwa and yourself. I have heard your accompaniment to Vishwa several times. I must say the rapt attention with which you look at Vishwa while holding the violin and looking right into him is something that people should realize. Obviously, you absorbed from him a lot of the nuances of music that Vishwas have taught you. In fact, your Saramaina Matalanta sounded so much like how Vishwa would do it. So the question comes, you know, how do instruments evolve?
Yeah, instruments too. Most of them have a folk origin. For example, the ghatam, let us start with a simple instrument. That ghatam is a folk instrument. The ghata singari, there's so many variations of the ghata, right? It comes from, the best ghatam is made from the clay of a place called Mana Madurai. Because this clay, which you find in that place, has a lot of metallic content. And hence the ringing sound of the ghatam is much better. Right, that is the folk origin. The use of, skin and leather of so many percussion instruments, what we call an avanadhavadya. correct? Whether it be the lizard skin of a kanjira or whether it be goat and buffalo skin combinations on a mridangam. The mridanga is such a fascinating instrument. It's a folk origin, but it's also a container of the wisdom and the intellect of the folk. Rural technology we speak of today, this mridangam can produce 100 sounds and not a single part of it is modern, so to speak. It's all village manufacturing. A dead buffalo, a dead goat, the skin of it tempered and smoothened and layered, and the wood, you know, the wood and the way of the both the left and right hand side, and it produces, is the most versatile percussion instrument I've ever come across. You listen to a Palakkad Mani Aiyar and you say, my God, how can this instrument produce hundreds of sounds? Fascinating. Absolutely mind-blowing. It's a recognition we have to bow down to the craft and the technological intellect of the village mind. All these instruments, in fact, even the violin, you know, there was a, there is one theory that Ravana never played the Veena, as we know. There are reliefs in Gujarat and Rajasthan in temples where an instrument called the Ravana Hatha, which is a bowed instrument, you know, like the probably the Kotanguchi that you see in streets even now in the villages, you know, it is coming from there. This probably travels to Europe, gets very refined in the hands of, you know, the 15th, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th century violin makers, culminating in Antonio Stradivari and Guarneri, who produced the finest violins, which now costs millions of dollars to buy, which I can only dream of. Anyway, unless there are some very, very, very rich people who want to sponsor a violin for me, that is, I will be very honored. So the violin comes back to us having gone through a cycle of transformation and travel. Every instrument, the Nagaswaram, folk. Its culture is folk. Because the recent instruments, of course, we have the Western instruments which are electronic and all that. But essentially, they don't form the rubric of Indian classical music instruments. Because they cannot produce the sounds. They cannot produce the overtones and the gamakas. How can a keyboard produce? How can a saxophone produce? The absolute analogous vistas of Carnatic music, impossible. So when we listen to these modern instruments also, I have nothing against them. I am just saying something very, very objectively. A keyboard cannot produce an Anand Bhairavi the way it has to be produced. It will still be ta-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Right? It will still be very, very digital. The analogous sound of ga and go. It will not be reproduced. The human voice is so magical. And some instruments like the Pulangural, the Basuri, the Nagaswaram, the violin, because of their analogous nature, they will be able to reproduce, come close to it, still not, you know, do it 100%. So the violin comes that way to us. But essentially, I believe that almost all the instruments, whether it be, you know, the yard is what becomes the veena. The yard again is a folk instrument. The Pulangural, of course, is a folk instrument. So all these origins are folk. We have to recognize that. Of course, they have undergone a lot of refinement. That I always, you know, make a note of that. Yeah. Venkat sir, next question, if we have time.
We have about 10 minutes.
Okay.
So, so how about lyrics? Do we, in the folk tradition, is the tune comes up or the words come up?
We don't know. Many times, the lyrics are very relevant to that world space. Like I said, a festival, or a Tevaram. A Tevaram also, the Shiva Bhakti is the source for the lyrics, right? We don't know how they sang. We have no record. So very difficult for us to comment upon how a Sundarar or an Appar sang the Devaram, or how a Mirabai sang her bhajan, or how a Kabir or a Surdas sang their compositions, or a Puradaradas also, we don't know. Annamacharya, we don't know. Bhadrachala Ramadasa, we don't know. There is no documentation of the melodic thing, because the melodic thing is very difficult to document. We don't have a written tradition of the music. So, we don't have a record of how they sang. But the words are easy to preserve, because the writing on say, some kind of a surface paper or a copper plate, that tradition has been there. I think folk also, the words and tune come together. For example, I will sing you one Sindhi song, which I've been talking too much. A Sindhi song which Bade Gulam Ali Khan used to sing, you know, is in Mande. All of you know Mande? Kesariya Balma, Balma, Padharu Marudesare. This Gama Badani Sa Dama Paga Gama Gaji Sa. Right, is band. It's such a beautiful melody. It is actually just the notes of Shankaravarman. But the orientation of it, the rasa, the kind of the murchana of it is very different. Right? Lal Misar's Tilana also in band, very beautiful. It draws from all this. In fact, Lal Misar's, many of the Tilanas are based on Hindustani ragas. So even this Mand Tilana, there is a history behind it. Where, having listened to Bade Gulam Ali Khan's, the Pahadi Tilana. Pahadi Tilana comes about because Boleti listens to this beautiful rendition of Hari Om Tat Sat. I don't know if you've heard. If you are a Rasika of any music, if you have not heard Hari Om Tat Sat of Bade Gulam Ali Khan Sahab, your life has been incomplete. So go back, put it on YouTube and listen to Hari Om Tat Sat. Hari Om Tat Sat is in Pahadi. You know Pahadi. The name itself refers to the mountain people, Pahadi. The tunes of the mountain people, Pahadi. So Mandala, for example, the Sindhi song. So then Mand, Pahadi, all of them are the wealth of the folk. Maran mithiyu galdi, maran mithiyu galdi, dam dam me yaad pavan jo maran mithiyu gal, ye dam dam me yaad pavan jo maran mithiyu galdi. Maran mitiyu galdi, dam damai me yaad pavan jo maran mitiyu galdi, maran mitiyu. Band kothola tule vihala, malhan ki na paya ma, malhan ki na paya. हितला पासे खुश गुजारिया धारण चारण दार दी दम दम में याद पवन जो पारन मिटियू गाल. This is a married song. Now here I can very very easily see that the lyric is very important. It celebrates the how the bride looks, etc. Now, and the setting is a standard Mand setting, but in the hands of a very good musician who's creative, I can keep adorning it. Bade Gulam Ali Khan Sahab adorns it with his virtuosity, with his thinking. But the tune is essentially that of the folk. Sa za da da ma pa ma ga ri sa. Right? So the tune is essentially folk. The words are relevant to the situation. Because all folk song is according to a situation. there is a context to it. Very opposed to our context is always in Carnatic music, it is devotion. 90%. It is devotion, whether it be Tyagaraja or... So the context is always spiritual and devotional.
Is there time to hear a small tumri from you?
Khamaj, another raga, which is very, our khamas, right? Is also a very rich raga, which has come to us from the folk. Right? So let me sing a small tumri. We don't have time. I'm very disturbed that I'm not able to do justice to all these. But I understand the situation. So going from one raga to the other without and speaking and not warming up is something which a singer should not do. But then I'm just trying to convey the idea of this continuum. So what is khamas or khamaj? Khamas in the Carnatic idiom, in Carnatic idiom, we are very particular about how we name our ragas. Our ragas have to mean something. The name has to mean something. So khamas doesn't mean anything, right? Either in Sanskrit or Telugu or Tamil, khamas doesn't mean anything. There is no word. Even the word sahana, what does it mean? It doesn't mean anything. Of course, now we will name our children sahana because it's such a beautiful thing. But there is no meaning for the word. So khamas is also one such raga name. So we know that it has come from somewhere else. Because if it was a South Indian, we are obsessed with nomenclature, right? We like to name everything. Meaning. So khamas and then khamaj. I will, the first thing khamas.
Mani dadapa, dani sasa, dani sadapa magama, mamagariza, samaga mani dadapa.
This is the chalan. This is the metta of khamas.
Samaga mani dapa danisa danisa gari magasa nisari ni ni dapa pasadapa magama.
Hindi nishadam. So it is not bothered about all those things. Right?
Modi chese vele ra idu kada modi chese vele ra Modi kesvele ra ne padi sarasavadi namo tadi namodi kesvele ra.
So the melody is only
ta 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 ta.
That's a typical melody for khamas. Then of course Tyagaraja and Dikshitar will take it apart because of their genius and explore the raga. Very amazingly, and it extends itself. My guru Vishwasari used to sing a composition, a javali, again a folk song.
Janaroi mohamu sahimpagalene janaroi.
Aha, it's a raga part.
Janaro
that akali nishada. Is where the rasa comes pouring in.
Janaro,
it's an anyaswara, okay? The anyaswara is the jiva swara of the raga. How can you explain that?
Janaro ee mohamu tagimpagalene.
Even the expression, is that a folk? She's saying, I'm not able to understand how this moham has happened to me. So that janaro, not know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, that expression, khamas takes it to a different level.
Janaroi, 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 mohamu, tagimbaga, ene, janaroi,
this I do. Because of my classical training. This the folk singer will not do. The met is his. The javali is his. From the folk. This is, I think, Pattaviram. No, this is Pattaviramayya, the composer. So, the idea is the folk. But I will give it, the classical musician gives it his sense of mastery, training, of the swaras, of the manodharma, nipunatvam. Nipunatvam means expertise. So I and other musicians will give it that dimension, expanding it. But the root is always folk. Description of Krishna. Rikhvanandana papakandana koti ravi saman abhushan tamake dari ki sari sohe tan mein. That is the revealing of the jari ki sari on the body of Krishna. Sohe tan mein choli ang sohe tan gani rat kamaj. This is called manj kamaj, a variation of kamaj. So that same thing, you know, which you see in Danaroi, it is the same method. Kaun gali gayo sham. So there is also an intermediary genre called Bandish ki Thumri. So the Bandish is a classical genre, like compositional form, and the Thumri is a folk genre. Somebody comes up with the idea that I want to justify a Thumri also in the style of Bandish. So then you have this genre called Bandish ki Thumri. Right? This is a Bandish ki Thumri, what I just sang. It has a form of, it has the rigidity of a classical composition. You know, having a sthai and the antara, the structure of a khayal Bandish. You know. So hundreds of Thumris in Pahadi, in what was I was singing Khamaj only. So Khamaj, there are so many Thumris. I wanted to sing one and I'm forgetting that.
Manamohana shamarasiya. Manamohana shamarasiya. Manamohana shamarasiya. Manamohana shamarasiya. Manamohana samarasiya. Manamohana, manamohana samarasiya.
My virtuosity, my understanding and my imagination of Khamaj. I can sing this line for half an hour without repeating even one sangati. That is the skill that the classical tradition has given me. But manamohana samarasiya, that remains a dhun, a melody from folk. So that is the continuum which we can, the classical music can extend it because of the training, because of the tayari or whatever your capabilities as a musician, as a thinking musician.
Manamohana, manamohana.
Manamohana means making me lose my mind. This Krishna is so beautiful, it makes me lose my mind. The only place where moha is a guna. Otherwise, moha is not a virtue. Right, it's a vice. It's so called, it's not desirable. But here alone, it is a virtue. Because you are losing your mind to him.
Manamohana shamarasiya. Niko aare. Niko lage. Basuri sunat sab sake yaaye. Prema gita sab ke man bhaave. Aso. Giridhara sadasada murali shamarasiya.
I'm forgetting the words. But a very beautiful thumri which I learned from a recording of Jagdish Prasad, the great singer, Badi Gulam Ali Khan's disciple.
Manamohana shamarasiya.
The flow of Khamaj.
Manamohana shamarasiya. Manamohana shamarasiya.
Way you will pronounce the words is also folk. folk la words pronounce mari nam classical musicians la pronounce pandrom we do it but it doesn't have that magic you know when I hear some folk musicians singing the words seem to be just flowing out of nowhere manamana shamarasiya so for a very intuitive and a very intense musician all these are what you know make life worth living in terms of noticing the absolute beauty of the sounding of the lyric of the folk musician there are some folk musicians that I've heard that I cannot remove the sound of theirs from my mind like I said Kumar Gandharva says that sound of the folk if you listen to for example even Carnatic greats like Tyagaraja Bhagavathar Dandapani Desigar you will feel this sound of the folk in their singing because they hail from such backgrounds you know Dandapani Desigar with the way he will sing Varugalamo of Gopalakrishna Bharati is amazing you should go and listen to it it's a 4-minute rendition which comes in the film very different from how Vishwa sir or KBN sir will sing that both of them are charming the Dandapani Desigan's rendition his beautiful rendition is more spontaneous is more immediate is more folk whereas Vishwa sir's or KBN sir's rendition of the same Varugalamo in Manji you can go and listen to KBN sir's or Vishwa sir's it is very cultured it's very refined it has the intellect within it but both of them are beautiful so it is this that we have to learn to seek and enjoy seek out the folk because there is so much of beauty embedded there that is there for you to rasichify you know I use the word rasichify as because a rasika cannot afford to be narrow then you are being unfair to yourself you say I will just listen to GNB Bani or I will just listen to Lalgudi Bani I will just you're putting constraints on yourself why don't even restrict yourself to classical music listen to folk and then you will you know it's also available for you as a gift from Ishwara that's why this continuum is something which I really celebrate this is the first time I'm presenting a talk on this subject actually I've spoken on a lot of subjects but this is because it is so fascinating I've always felt that I've always you know rejoiced in this continuum
Sri Ram sir this is wonderful this is a wonderful presentation that you have given and it comes to you remind me of experience with Vishwa I would like to narrate one incident I drove Vishwa to New York to see Lalgudi Jayaraman's Jai Jai Devi in the car he said play Sri Ram Parasam's vocal music with his brother which you had performed in Hartford and on listening he had appreciation for your paras nilaya daksh
nilaya daksh
and Sri Abhayamba in Sri he spoke so very highly about it but knowing you with that exotic musical form I would not have guessed that you would have gone though this broad and acquired so much of very different genre and seen that as a continuum congratulations I now invite Shekhar Vishwanathan to make the final concluding remarks Shekhar ji
can you hear me we have had we are indeed singularly lucky to have had one of the most prolific probably well learned both a practitioner of music and by the way he is an engineer by qualification he is a Calcutta IIM MBA and of course as a Western violinist Dr. Venkatachalam mentioned and of course a PhD in music from Wesleyan College so you can imagine the amount of depth of knowledge he has he can talk for hours I have listened to him many times at the academy and of course we are so fortunate to have him give this specific talk for the first time, most importantly, connecting the origin of the folk music connectivity to the Indian classical music, and that too in both genres of music, Hindustani as well as the Carnatic. And as we saw him for the hour or so, he can sing both of them so fluently. And by the way, we are well connected to C.R. Vyas family because Satish Vyas is a fantastic and a well-known lover of, I would say, Indian Fine Arts Academy, has performed here many times as well. Once again, we want to, on behalf of the managing trustees and Dr. Venkatachalam, Raven Subramaniam, and other board members, and I want to thank you for making this possible for San Diego as well as the worldwide audience. And this is a very unique legdum, a conversation, as Revathi called, and we would really like to have you come back and give us all your intellectual information, what you have, which is probably more than what the time can allow us in that regard. Once again, we want to thank you. And I want to thank, special thanks to Dr. Venkatachalam, Revathi Subramaniam, Narayanan Gopala for making this possible as well. And please don't forget, his wife is equally a fantastic singer, very well-known Bollywood singer, Srimati Anuradha Sriram. And I know that she's watching this program. And she is scheduled to come in. And she's going to talk about, in this case, ragas and film music. So please don't miss it. That is scheduled for October 3rd at the same time frame. So please do mention to all your friends, relatives, and of course, musical rasikas all over the world. Once again, our sincere thanks to you, Dr. Sriram Prasaram, and please
thank
do
so
visit
much.
Us again.
Thank you.
And thank you so much.
It has been a sheer joy for me to share some of these thoughts. Like I said, if by chance I have said something which is offensive in terms of, you know, status, etc., that is, those are just objective observations of mine. There is no disrespect meant at all, not even remotely. You know, it has been a joy to share some of these things. Like I say, the gurus have shared very generously with me, and all the credit goes to them and my parents for having nurtured my musicality, and of course for my family, my entire family, my brother, sister, even now, Anuradha, my children. Somehow the God, Ishvara's blessings that they have nurtured the spirit of mine in music. And then I'm exceptionally grateful to all of you who have come this evening and, you know, been part of this inspiration to share some of my thoughts on this continuum of the folk and classical. Thank you very much. Venkatachalam sir has been a very old friend from the time I remember the first time I had dinner at his house after I was accompanying Tanjavur's Kalyan Raman at Boston.
That's quite
then,
true.
His mother, such a lovely darling, and he, family, so I know him for a long, long, long time. And recently when I went to perform at San Diego, I was so happy to meet him again and learn of all the contributions of his teaching, etc., that he's doing for the community there. Absolutely brilliant. We need that. And so to be part of this conversation with him. And Revathi ma'am, your introduction and your setting up the topic, I think was very critical for it to proceed so well. Thank you so much. Thank you all. Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha.
Namaskaram.
Yes.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you very much.